Hello and welcome to another episode in the Godot Basics Tutorial Series. Godot Tutorials is not affiliated with or sponsored by Godot Game Engine. In this episode, we take a look at the LightOccluder2D Node class. The LightOccluder2D Node class inherits from the Node2D class, which ultimately inherits from the Node class, meaning we do have access to those life cycle scripts. The LightOccluder2D node occludes or obstructs light cast by the Light2D node, and this is where the shadows come from. The LightOccluder2D must be provided with an occluder polygon2D in order for the shadows to be computed. The LightOccluder2D comes with two properties. The first is the light mask property. By default, you are set to layer 1. The second property is called occluder, which is your occluder polygon2D data type. And by default, this is empty, meaning you have to set this up yourself. Now, the occluder polygon2D is a resource class, and you're going to need to provide this resource to your LightOccluder2D node in order to get your shadows working. Basically, the occluder polygon2D facilitates the drawing of your 2D polygon. Your 2D polygon is used for the LightOccluder2D node. The occluder polygon2D comes with three properties. The first is the closed property, which is a Boolean data type, and by default, this is set to true. The second is your co mode, and it needs to be provided a co mode enum data type. In this case, the default value is 0, meaning that no culling will be applied. And the last property is your polygon, and this holds all the points you provide, which ultimately is used when creating or casting your shadow. Now, the closed property is set to true, and all this means is that does the first index of the polygon array connect with the last index of the polygon array? The co mode, which again is set to 0 by default, comes with three options. The first is disabled, the second is clockwise, and the third is counterclockwise. And just like the name implies, either culling is disabled, culling is performed in the clockwise direction, or culling is performed in the counterclockwise direction. And again, lastly, the polygon property holds your occluder polygon points, which is ultimately used when creating or casting your shadow. By default, Light2D does not cast a shadow even when you provide a LightOccluder2D node onto your game scene. And this is because the Light2D has a property called shadow enabled, and by default, this is set to false. In order to cast shadows onto your game scene, you need to change the value of shadow enabled to true. Now, once you've set the shadow enabled value to true, the Light2D node comes with five properties that allow you to change the look and feel of your shadows, or rather the shadows you cast onto your game scene. The first property is called shadow color, and when you change the color of the shadow color property, you do in fact change the color that your shadows cast in. The second property is called shadow gradient length, and by changing this value, you can change the gradient of your shadow when it's cast. The third property is shadow filter, and by default, your shadows have no filter. However, you can change how many sample sizes you'd wish to apply onto your shadow. Basically, the more filters you apply, the more organic your shadow looks when being casted. The fourth property is shadow filter smooth. When you set the shadow filter value, you most likely want to set the shadow filter smooth value as well. And again, the higher your number is for the shadow filter smooth value, the more organic your shadow will look. And lastly, you do have a shadow item cull mask, and so you can control which layers you want to cast shadows onto, and by default, this is set to layer 1. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at an example. So in here, I have three different game objects. The first is our light source, and I put the picture of Godot just to show you visually where exactly the light source is emanating from. The second object will be our game object in which we will apply shadow to, and the last game object is the background. Without the background, we are unable to see where our light is touching or affecting, or even see where the shadow is being casted from. Now first, let's go ahead and set up our LightOccluder2D node. So first you want to pick the game object in which you would like to apply your LightOccluder2D node. In this case, I would like to apply it to the game object called shadow source. Press the plus button in the search bar, type out LightOccluder, and select it. By default, it will give a soft error. In order to fix that, all you need to do is set a polygon. And so in this case, if we go to the Inspector tab and select the Occluder object, you will be given a drop-down menu, and you just go ahead and pick Occluder Polygon. And the soft error is still going to show because we need to apply polygon points. So let's go ahead and do that right now. So in this case, I'm going to mark the entire square, and I'm going to close it off. And that's basically it. Now, if the error message is still showing, that's okay. Sometimes it does that. You can just move it back in, and all will be fine. Now, as you can see here, there is no shadow being processed, and that's because our Light2D node has the shadow set to false. So in this case, all you need to do is click on Light2D in the Inspector tab, go ahead, select the shadow drop-down options, and in the Enabled section, make sure you checkbox that into True, and now we can see the shadow being applied. So let me zoom out a little bit. So as you can see here, once we've applied the shadow enabled property to true, a shadow is being casted. Now, if we move our light source around, you can see that shadow is being calculated based on the position of our light source. Now, if we select LightOccluder2D, we have several options available to us. To open the options, all you have to do is click in the box that says Occluder Polygon, and you can see all the default values, close set to false, call mode set to disabled, and of course, because we have to set up our polygon points, we've created an array of polygon points. If you click on that, you can see all the points and their individual locations. Now, in this case, we have 4 points, 1, 2, 3, 4, and it is closed. And all closed means is that our first element is connected to our last element. Now, if we uncheck the closed option, all that means is that the last element does not connect with the first element, and so when we move into the opening, light is being applied to everything inside that game object. And if we move out, you can see that shadow is now being applied inside. And so in this case, only the top border, the right portion of our border, and our bottom borders are applying shadow, whereas the left side of this game object is not applying shadow. So of course you have your clockwise and your counterclockwise options. They do different effects based on different things. And you just have to play around with these effects in order to get the look and feel of shadow effects you want. Now, another important thing is setting up values in the Light2D node. So in this case, color, in this case, it's set to 0000 by default. However, you can also change the colors of your shadow by changing the color value inside the shadow color property. I'm going to set this back to default. On top of that, you have gradient length. So in this case, how many gradients or how transparent you want your shadow to start from before hitting solid colors. So you can see the higher the number, the more transparency your shadow has onto the background object. I'm going to set this back to 0. Next, let's take a look at the filter. Allow me to zoom in onto the shadow so you can see the filter effect being applied onto our shadow. So in this case, filter is set to none. However, if we set it to 3, you can see that we use 3 samples, 1, 2, 3. And the more samples we use, the more is added towards the edge. And so obviously the more samples you have, the more organic your shadows can look like. And on top of that, we have the smooth filter. So let me zoom back in again. In this case, the more we smooth, the wider they get. But in this case, when we zoom out, you can see that our shadow looks more organic. So let me reset everything to its default value, and you can see that our shadow is very straight. In this case, I'm going to apply 13. I'm going to smooth it out, and you can sort of see that the shadow looks and feels smooth when you keep it within certain bounds. Now, lastly, let's take a look at the item call mask for our shadow property. In this case, we are affecting everything in layer 1, and by default, everything accepts shadow from layer 1. However, let's say we only want our shadows to be affected by layer 2. In this case, I'm going to set it to layer 2 only. Now, we need to head into our LightOccluder2D and set the same thing to our light mask. Now, there's something I want you to notice here in light mask. When we set the light mask here inside of our LightOccluder2D, we also affect the light mask in our canvas item. So something to note that the light mask in LightOccluder2D connects with the canvas item light. Now, let's go ahead and set the light mask to only be affected by light in layer 2, and you'll notice that there's no shadow, and that's because our background also needs to be affected by things in layer 2 as well in order to have the shadow applied onto it. So in this case, we're only being affected by shadows in layer 2. So if I were to turn off this light occluder in layer 2, notice how it's on and off. And at the same time, because this shadow is being applied onto our background object, we also need our background object to have light mask being affected by things in layer 1 and layer 2. So in this case, when we do canvas item, we're dealing not only with shadows, but also light. And so we need to keep 1 and 2 on for our background to be affected by light and shadow. Anyway, that's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you so much for joining me. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to leave them in the comment section down below. I'm going to go ahead and upload this example to GitHub. No code, just the example. Thank you so much for joining me, and I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.